go to Matthew chapter 5, the Sermon on the Mount, which is Matthew 5, 6, and 7. And I do plan to be done a little before 10:30 today to greet visitors as they're coming in. We've been in our Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. This is the third Sunday. Today, I want to wrap that portion of the Sermon on the Mount in a nice package, review, get current, and finish the ones we have not done. Someone has called this the Magna Charter of the Christian believer, and it is. This is what we are like. This is what we're like in here. And it flows to the outside life. So first of all, I want to again read the entire passage, which is really verse 3 through 12, but I'll begin in verse number 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. Matthew 9, verse 37 and 8, another occasion where he saw the multitudes, it says, Jesus was moved with compassion. That needs to be our, that's how we need to be in here, when we see people. When you see a bunch of people, especially if you see them in a lifestyle that's contrary to Christ, how do you feel about that in here? Does it make you mad? Does it make you angry? Or do you even care? Or are you moved with compassion? The Lord Jesus Christ, when he saw lost people, was moved with compassion. And by the way, when he saw believers, he was moved with compassion. He saw them as sheep without a shepherd. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, what we have is the longest recorded sermon of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is a significance of him going to a mountain. God the Father presented the law on a mountain. He, the gospel, the law, the word of the Lord, the finishing, the gospel of grace and love on a mountain. The first time the people were ordered to keep at a distance, here they are invited to come. That was presented with smoke, fire, and thunder. This with the spirit of love. That was only to the Jewish folks. This is to all people. Number one, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. This, the introduction to them all. This is foundational. Blessed are the poor in spirit. It is a humbling spirit before the Lord. It is contentedly poor, if that's our lot in life. It is lowly in our own eyes. Instead of a spirit of I'm better than them. It is a lowly spirit. It is a spirit of having no confidence in us as our hope of heaven. It is a lowliness of ourselves. It is a dependence wholly on the Lord Jesus Christ and his grace and his strength. It is a contriteness and a brokenness in our own ability. The Apostle Paul learned and taught us the way up is down. It is the opposite spirit of the world. And this is first. If this is not right, everything else will not be right either. Blessed are the poor in spirit. It is our spiritual attitude toward ourselves, which is, as John put it, when the Lord began his public ministry, He must increase, I must decrease. Number two, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Interesting, just the opposite of the world. Not the merry, but they that mourn will be comforted. Christ was the great mourner, our example. A mourning over sin, a mourning over others, a mourning, a godly sorrow, mourning over the sin of others, and mourning over the affliction of others. When, James taught us, when others are happy, we should be happy with them. When they sing, we should sing. But when they mourn and are hurting, we should be too. We are a spiritual family. Number three is verse number five. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. A quiet submission to the will of God. Not our will, but the Lord's will be done. I used David, the king, as an illustration, who, when his son ran him and his entourage out of Jerusalem, and he had the ark returned, which he should have never taken, he said, "It is the Lord, let him do to me as seemeth him good." Think about this, Jesus Christ made himself of no reputation.
Right.
You know, also our reputation is really important. Do you know the most valuable thing on earth you have that you have on earth is your name? It's not your possessions, it's your name. And when someone defames us, that's hard to take. It's hard to take. Oh, you want to rise up. Well, and sometimes you should, but if it's in the work of the Lord, sometimes we have to take it. Meekness. That means gentle toward other men. Most of the time, folks will respond back to you as you respond to them. Most of the time. Christians need to become masters at controlling the conversation with others. Think about that a minute. We need to be masters at controlling the conversation with others. And how you do that is when you go to others, when you talk to others, it's your spirit and the tone of your voice and how prayed up you are when you go to talk to them. When you go into a conversation like a lion roars, you will get bit. But when you go into a situation like a lamb, you're going to be able to control the conversation. Silent when it's necessary and soft-spoken when it's necessary. The Bible talks about believers in patience possessing their souls. Meek spirit. Forgive. Don't revenge. Don't belittle. Blessed are the meek. Number four, blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. Blessed are they, verse 6, which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. What, deep down in here where only God knows you, what do you hunger and thirst for the most? Well, we know that there were millions upon millions upon millions last night who were more than anything in the world hungering and thirsting after that $800 million. What a con game. By the way, there was a winner of the $800 million lottery last night. The government. The government. They get to keep it. Let me tell you something, folks. Pardon me. Can I ramble a minute and leave my text? The only way to win the lottery is never play. Yeah. Amen. Everybody still awake in here? You want to get rich? God said, get a job. You don't take from the poor to make yourself rich. Did you know if you do, you got a curse on your life? I have a sermon. You remember when Granny Ann Richardson got, the legacy of her administration as governor, 25 years ago? Well, she voted in gambling in Texas. What a legacy! Boo humbug! That's what I mean by what a legacy. The next Sunday morning, I stayed up half a Saturday night, and I got a sermon. It's called 10 Reasons Why a Christian Should Not Gamble. And I preached it the next morning. But I'm here to, by the way, that was at Countryside Baptist Church in Cleburne, Texas. Let me tell you right now, it went over like a lead balloon. They did not like it. And I didn't learn my lesson there, folks, because about 6 months later, I got invited to preach to the Dallas Baptist Convention of the BMA in Dallas, Texas, to about 75 preachers, and that's what I preach. You never had such a, Ron, you never had such a negative spirit, a bunch of preachers when I preached that sermon.
You mean it was like eating a sandwich?
It went over like a lead balloon.
Like eating a sandwich at a rabbi convention?
A beef sandwich, yeah.
No, ham.
A ham sandwich at a rabbi convention. Yeah. You fed in popcorn again this morning, didn't you? I'm telling you, you're going to stop that. I'm not saying I'm going to preach it here. I'm not a glutton for punishment anymore. Where was I when I got interrupted? Oh, hunger and thirst after righteousness. What do we hunger for?
Good question.
Only you can answer that. Hunger and thirst after righteousness, that means spiritual blessings. The Lord, the Word, the good of your fellow believers, the spiritual growth of our church, the spiritual growth of your family, the souls of your family, the coming kingdom of Christ, all that is good and honorable and godly. Hunger and thirst after righteousness. Now, a hunger and thirst comes to you every day. And so you need to have constant renewing by the power of the Holy Spirit of grace to hunger and thirst after righteousness. And the Bible says, they shall be filled.
Yeah.
I met with someone this week. And it didn't take me but about 5 minutes into the conversation to figure out his problem was he never opened the Word of God and prayed. Claimed to be a Christian. I can't be a judge of that. Actually, I think he probably was. There wasn't a spiritual discernment there that I think the Holy Spirit was inside him, but he wasn't working on it at all. I asked him, I said, "Ha, when was the last time you read your Bible?" Well, never mind his answer, but it's a while ago. What about your prayer? Well, what prayer? Like? Folks, to be a good Christian, you got to hunger and thirst after righteousness. What is one of the first signs of a sick physical body? You lose your appetite. Amen, Brother Ken?
Amen.
What's one of the first signs of spiritual anemia? You've quit reading your Bible and praying. You got a hunger and thirst after righteousness. And by the way, if you don't, you do it anyway because God said so. And guess what? When you start doing it, your spiritual appetite comes back. The nurse in the hospital comes in with lunch. I'm not hungry. What does she say? You got to eat to get your strength back. You got to eat to get your spiritual strength back, folks. Amen? All right. Number 5. Verse number 7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Here's a paradox. In the world, you got to have it to give it, but not in the Christian race. God accepts the desire for the real thing. Merciful, be good to others. Bear with others' afflictions. You want others to be merciful to you? You must be merciful. They who are merciful shall obtain mercy. Be good to people. Be kind to people. The Bible even talks about a man being good to his beast. My wife has two cats. I have to practice that one every day. When I want to kick them clear across the kitchen floor, I got to look at them and smile and walk away. I guess it's good practice to make me more merciful. By the way, I do like them. Not as much as my cat likes them, as much as my wife likes them, but I do like them. I'd rather have a German Shepherd.
Amen.
But now see, here's a problem in marriage. She likes cats, and I'd rather have her cats. I like a German Shepherd. She says no. Can I get a little advice here? You guys think it's funny, don't you?
At least he'd have two good meals.
I like you, Brother Cam. I like you a lot. Now, my wife, she may not like you after I tell her what you said. I like you, Brother Cam. Merciful. Merciful. Let me tell you something. It's a cruel world out there. Christians need to become good to people. Amen?
Amen.
Treat people mercifully.
Amen.
By the way, we should be merciful to others because we have received mercy.
Amen.
Amen. All right. They're blessed. They will obtain mercy. Number 6 is verse number 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Now, this is the most comprehensive one. If your heart is right with the Lord, then all these other things will come into play a lot easier. Pure in heart. Single toward God. Single toward God. If you've got a heart that's divided, you know, the opposite of pure is dirty. Nothing but sin and bad stuff in there. Pure also in the sense of single, not part in the world and part in, you love God, but you also love whatever in the world. A single heart toward God, an undivided heart toward God. Pure in heart. And by the way, let me correct a theological error that's rampant today. When you get saved, and I know what people mean by this, hear me out completely. When people say, well, give your heart to Jesus. God doesn't want your heart. He wants all of you.
Yeah.
And secondly, God doesn't want anything from you. He wants to give you something. A new nature. A new nature. The heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. Let me ask you a question. If you gave your heart to Jesus, how come some of the awful stuff still flows through your heart that only you and God know about? Now, we get down here about some serious theology that a lot of people disagree with. Getting saved is to receive what God gives you. New life, a new nature, the Holy Spirit. You haven't got anything that God can use until you are saved. And then you're all His, pure in heart. Pure in character. Purified by faith. And then begins a lifetime of what we call sanctification. See, salvation does not stand alone. The opposite side of salvation is sanctification. Whom the Lord saves, he sanctified. If you're not being sanctified, you need to question your salvation. It's a two-edged sword that you can't separate. Salvation and sanctification. Now, some people grow quicker than others, but the fact is, from the day you receive Christ to the day you go to be with the Lord, or he comes for us, you need to be growing in grace, pure in heart. The pure heart will do what? See God. The greatest blessing that you can have this side of eternity is to see God spiritually. Spiritually, see God. And only those who are pure in heart, only those who are growing in grace and are living the Christian life to the best of their ability, the greatest blessing is not to win the lottery, is not to buy a $100,000 car, is not to get a nice brand new house. All those things are nice if you can do it, and if you won't compromise your Christianity, go ahead. But folks, the greatest blessing that you can come to a believer in this side of the cemetery is to see God spiritually. And then on the other side of the cemetery, to be with him there, literally. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Number 7. This will be verse number 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. You see, the saved are first pure toward God and then peaceable toward man, and I do mean in that order. If you've got war in here, if there's conflict in here, you're going to have problems out here. Many times if people come to me and they've got relationship problems, it doesn't take but a second to see they've got relationship problems with themselves. Well, you can't be at war in here and get along with people out there. Men come home at the end of the day and they're mad because they've had nothing but trouble at work. They take it out on their wives. And vice versa. She's had a bad day. And you come home and how's supper? I'm cooking tonight. Take care of this in here. It's going to help an awful lot with everybody out there, peacemakers. Now, Christians ought to be peacemakers. You know, the history of the Christian church has been when societies fall apart, it's the Christians that get blamed. It started at Rome, and it's always been that way. What cause was there for Hitler to take his wrath out on the Jews? What cause was there and is there the way that Christians today are being maligned in America and the Bible cast out and the conservatives, which are usually the Christians, which the news media won't say, but the conservatives, we're counted as the troublemakers. That's part of it. Before you become a Christian, before you side in with Christians, you need to count the cost and you need to be willing to take up your cross. Why are Christians in Muslim countries, if they're caught with the Bible, they cut their hand off? Or they throw them in jail? And if they are caught witnessing to a Muslim, they stone them to death. What cause is that? Because we're the peacemakers. And a warring, hateful, devil-controlled world hates that. Peacemakers. Peaceable disposition. Be peaceful. You not only need to have the peace of God, which comes in salvation, but the peace with God, to live that way after you are saved. And then you'll have a peaceful disposition. And when you have a peaceable disposition, then you can have a peaceable conversation. They are blessed. They are called the children of God. And then number 8, the persecuted. Verse 10, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Now, persecuted because of our ill doing is not blessed. But persecuted for, you did right. You stayed by your conviction. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you, verbally attack you, and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice. Now that's just the opposite of the world. See, Christians can rejoice because of who is inside, never mind what's going on in here. Well, Dr. John Rice, I was thinking about this yesterday when I was studying this a little bit. How many times I've heard him say, because in the last years of his life, I was with him some. Got to where at 80, he was still going 90 mile an hour, traveling everywhere alone, but there was always someone assigned at where, whatever church he was going to kind of watch over him, and I did a little of that, because he was just to the point where he couldn't do that anymore, shouldn't have been doing it anymore at that point. But I would hear him say, what kind of a Christian are you? Have you never lost a job for Jesus? Have you never lost a friend for Jesus? Have you never been isolated for Jesus? Have you never suffered for Jesus? Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. First of all, I want you to see the case described. Persecuted, defamed, maligned, accused, rejected. Listen, Christians in America today are persecuted. It just isn't physical yet. The closer you will walk to the Lord, you'll find out the farther your friends will put you from them. Evil said about us. Jude 15, of all the hard speeches that all hard sinners have said against you, that puts you out of their synagogue thinking they're doing God's service. I've seen lots of churches break up in my lifetime. I've heard of even more. By the way, not all church breakups are wrong. Sometimes a Christian just has to say, I can't stay here anymore. Sometimes churches make decisions that a committed believer just can't live with. And yes, I've seen churches break up where the wrong people stayed and the good people had to leave. How many denominations in our lifetime, in the last 50 years, have some of us seen break up? And invariably, it was the minority of God-fearing people who had to walk away. Like I had to walk away from the BMA, and so many of us preachers in the minority, but so many of us preachers had to walk away from the BMA because they were making decisions that were against God's convictions. I was in one independent, by the way, I'm not in anybody's ministry today, but I was in an independent Baptist movement early in my life, and a group of us had to walk away because decisions were being made that were not godly decisions. They'll separate you. Why? For righteousness' sake. Sometimes you just have to be spiritually mature and say, this just isn't right. I cannot, as a believer, I can no longer be a part of this. And I tell people sometimes out on visitation, now if they're making a change from a Church of Life, Faith, and Order, I simply say, you pray about it. You do what God wants you to do. But if I'm talking to people and they're part of a church that doesn't believe in grace, that doesn't believe in the King James Bible, that doesn't believe in salvation by grace, that doesn't believe in deity, that doesn't believe in a separated Christian living, and I feel they're really believers, I don't make any bones about it. You need to find you another church. What did Jesus say on one occasion? He said, I didn't come to unite, I came to separate. And I know we don't like this, but folks, sometimes you're put in a situation, you got to separate. Yep. Persecution. Now it's emotional for a lot of us. Will it ever go to physical? I think eventually it will. When? I don't know. How? I don't know. Who? I don't know. We've had it awful easy in our life. Amen. It's been easy to be a Christian in our lifetime. Amen.
Amen.
I mean, they may have called us a name. They may have not wanted to be around us. And they may have said, oh, here comes that Bible thumper again. Man, so what? There's folks dying for the same thing everywhere else. So, man, we've had it easy. Praise God for that. I remember as a little boy, soldiers with guns coming. We haven't had any of that here. Praise God. But yet, if you try to be a real good Christian, yeah, there's persecution. Mild, verbal, unspoken, but yeah. But here's what the Lord said. You're blessed. Now the world couldn't understand that. You say that to a lost people, they just look like you're crazy. But I think a Christian ought to be able to understand that you're blessed. Because see, you're laying up rewards in heaven. God's not going to be your debtor or my debtor at all. Blessed. You're blessed. You're glorifying Christ. You're going to receive comfort. Second, you're recompensed in the kingdom of heaven. It's the joy set before us. Thirdly, you're walking in the steps of a great Christian. You're walking in the steps of a great Christian. And fourthly, the Lord said, rejoice and be glad. Amen.